Yeah, thank you, Dr. Pandey. A very warm good evening to all. At the outset, I wish to express my gratitude to the Scientific Committee of ACP India for giving me this opportunity to interact with you all. From patient's perspective, excess of most blood values is undesirable and worrisome, like high blood sugar, high cholesterol, high renal function tests, high liver function tests.
Sorry to interrupt you. Share your slides.
I have already shared.
The slides are not coming.
Oh, just wait a minute. I've already shared. Okay, just wait a minute. Okay. Where the option for the share light? Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yes. Yeah. No, it is so, visible, sir.
Yeah. I think I'll repeat. I was audible, am I right? Yeah.
Yes, sir, you're audible. Yeah. You were audible at that time also.
Yeah, thank you very much. From patient's perspective, the excess of most blood values is undesirable and worrisome, like high blood sugar, high cholesterol, high renal function test, high liver function test, etc. However, one blood value which gives smile on patient's face is high hemoglobin, thinking that it is an indicator of good health. But to the treating doctor, it is a disturbing sign. Today, I'll be talking on an issue of excess hemoglobin, which is technically labeled as polycythemia or erythrocytosis. Polycythemia refers to an increased red cell mass. We all know that red cell mass is estimated by isotope dilution method, which is a very costly and cumbersome affair and is only available in few centers of the country. Therefore, the equivalent parameters which we use in clinical practice are hemoglobin or hematocrit. Now, erythrocytosis or polycythemia is labeled when hemoglobin is more than 6.5 gram per deciliter in men and 6 gram or more in women. Correspondingly, the hematocrit value of more than 49% in men and more than 48% in women is labeled as polycythemia. Now, before I come to the lecture, main part of my lecture, I would like to just clarify certain terminology. Relative polycythemia refers to a state of hemoconcentration. Because of decrease in blood plasma volume, there is elevation of hemoglobin and hematocrit. But remember, in this condition, there is no increase in the red cell mass, which is the basic definition of polycythemia. Absolute polycythemia refers to increase in the actual RBC mass and can be categorized either as primary or secondary. Primary is usually due to mutation, which is either acquired or inherited in the RBC progenitor cells. And secondary polycythemia occurs because of increase of red cell mass, which is caused by high concentration of erythropoietin. Now, before coming to the main part of the lecture, I would just take 3 cases for illustration of this entity. Case number one, a 47-year-old dentist, he presented with routine blood tests showing high hemoglobin and high hematocrit. Platelets were normal and patient had hyperuricemia and subnormal ferritin levels. On interrogation, the dentist said that he is perfectly all right, he has been working more than 10 hours a day, but when he was interrogated much minutely, he acknowledged to have occasional scotoma and tinnitus in the last few weeks. The physical examination was unremarkable, except that he had mild hypertension. Case number two is a 60-year-old man who was a heavy smoker, and he was found to have high hemoglobin and hematocrit with slightly mild thrombocytosis. A year back, he had suffered an acute myocardial infarction. At that time, hemoglobin and hematocrit were high, but it was not further investigated. He was on medication for hypertension, diabetes, and he was taking antiplatelet aspirin. Presently, he complained of tiredness, itching, and paresthesia. On physical examination, the spleen was found to be palpable 5 centimeters from the left costal margin. Case three is a patient, Mr. Shah, who has diabetes, hypertension, but he's a non-smoker, very high values of hemoglobin, hematocrit, saturation is normal, and erythropoietin is quite high. Now, changing the gears, I would just discuss what are the causes of polycythemia. I have already said relative polycythemia occurs because of volume contraction, because of diuretics, vomiting, diarrhea, and so on. Absolute polycythemia could be primarily, and we are primarily concerned with polycythemia vera, which is acquired somatic mutation. Among the secondary causes of polycythemia include anything which causes hypoxia, or this could be related to cardiopulmonary disease, this could be kidney disease, or could be because of autonomous erythropoietin production by certain tumors like hepatocellular carcinoma, renal cell carcinoma, hemangioblastoma, pheochromocytoma. And of course, there are other causes including androgens, anabolic steroids, and cobalt toxicity. Now, what is polycythemia? Now, most of the time in clinical practice, it is discovered incidentally when a high hemoglobin hematocrit is noted on complete blood count, which is being ordered for some other reason. However, few patients do present with disease-related symptoms like headache, dizziness, visual disturbances, pruritus, early satiety, or have complications like most common is thrombosis, and less common is major GI bleed or major bleeding from other sites. Now, these are the basic questions one should always ask to the patient when you are evaluating a patient of polycythemia. This could be related to personal or medical history, which could be the work exposure, especially exposure to ionizing radiation or benzene, then past history of cancer, surgical interventions, or any cardiovascular event in the past. In females, you ask about the menopause. In the family history, it is important to ask about the diagnosis of myeloproliferative neoplasm in any other family member, or patients who or the family members have erythrocytosis, or any family member has thrombotic event in unusual sites or at an unusual age. In the lifestyle, it is very important to talk about ask about the smoking, the physical activity, dietary habits, and the concomitant comorbidities, especially the cardiovascular risk factors like diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, high uric acid. One should always ask about the medications, especially the chronic use of corticosteroids, androgens, and diuretics. For in females, one should ask about the current and the past use of contraceptives and details of any uneventful pregnancies. Then the most important thing is that one should interrogate the patient for various constitutional symptoms, which I've already said. And these are very important for, because many times these patients have only subtle changes and they do not report to the doctor. Now, this group has evaluated more than 1,500 patients of polycythemia, and they studied, they found that hypertension is present in nearly 46% patients, palpable spleen is palpable in 36%, pruritus another 36%, vasomotor symptoms, especially erythromelalgia, in nearly 29 patients. These patients usually present with arterial thrombosis, less commonly venous thrombosis, and 4% of patients can present with major bleeding. There are other physical findings which are suggestive of polycythemia, like injection of the conjunctival small vessels, or the on fundus examination, there could be engorgement of the veins. Patient can have facial pleothora, or enlarged spleen can be seen in the minority of cases. Pruritus is a very common symptom, and it leads to excoriation of the skin. Of course, the stigma of arterial venous thrombosis in the past is also the important feature of polycythemia vera, and patients can present less gouty arthritis also. Now, this is a classical picture of erythromelalgia, and this is a condition which is associated with burning pain in the feet and hands, and is accompanied by erythema, pallor, and cyanosis. The peripheral pulses are palpable, and is also seen in other condition, that is essential thrombocytosis. Now, how do we diagnose polycythemia? Now, we have WHO diagnostic criteria of 2014. We have the major criteria where hemoglobin is more than 6.5 in men, more than 6 in women, or correspondingly the hematocrit is more than 49 in men and 48 in women, or there could be increased red cell. Of course, I've told you this is a cumbersome, costly affair. So usually we go by hemoglobin hematocrit parameters. Second important criteria is the bone marrow biopsy, which shows trilineage hyperplasia. And the third and most important is the presence of JAK2 mutations in the exon 14 or exon 12 of the JAK2 gene. And the minor criteria includes the subnormal serum erythropoietin level. So the diagnosis of polycythemia requires that all three major criteria are present, or the first two major criteria and the minor criteria of subnormal erythropoietin level. Now, how do we diagnose and approach a patient who comes with a confirmed diagnosis of polycythemia? In clinical practice, what we do is that we order for JAK2 mutations, that is the JAK2 exon 14 mutation and erythropoietin level. Now, we have three options. In option one, JAK2 mutation on exon 14, that is B617, is positive and erythropoietin level is subnormal, and therefore the diagnosis is very clear, polycythemia. The second option is the JAK2 V617, that is 14 exon mutation, is absent, but patient has subnormal erythropoietin level. Now, how further should we investigate this group of patients? Then we should go for the second mutation of JAK2, that is the exon 12 mutation, and bone marrow biopsy. If exon 12 is positive and bone marrow shows trilineage hyperplasia, again the diagnosis is clear cut, that is of polycythemia vera. However, if JAK exon 12 mutation is negative, bone marrow biopsy is not consistent with the diagnosis of polycythemia, then usually what we test is for the EPO receptor mutations, and these are very rare conditions in fact. What the third option is, when patient has JAK2 mutations are negative, but erythropoietin level is either normal or increased. When it is normal, then one should follow this algorithm, because nearly 4% of patients with polycythemia vera can have normal erythropoietin level. And it's very important that we should not miss this entity. If erythropoietin level is high and JAK2 mutation is negative, then we are dealing with secondary erythrocytosis. The various causes I've already enumerated in my previous slide, and we can proceed. If no other cause can be found out, then we should consider for germline mutation, but these are very rare conditions in clinical practice. A little bit about JAK2 mutation, because it is a major important advance in the understanding of myeloproliferative neoplasm, and it is a marker for non-CML classical MPN. And there's enough data to support its role in the pathogenesis of polycythemia vera. Now, 2015, four group of scientists, they had published papers in very high impact factor journals in the same year, underlying the importance of JAK2 mutation in myeloproliferative neoplasm. Now, the classical JAK2 mutation, what we see is the mutation in exon 14 of the JAK2 gene, where it is the valine at 617 is replaced by phenylalanine. Now, it is very important to remember that JAK2 mutation is positive in nearly 96% of patients with polycythemia vera, and it is positive in nearly half the patients with essential thrombocytosis and primary myelofibrosis. Now, when we talk about classical myeloproliferative neoplasms, JAK2 positive MPN means polycythemia vera or ET or PMF. Or if JAK2 is negative, then we are dealing either with essential thrombocytosis or primary myelofibrosis. Remember, JAK2 mutation is never seen in CML, very rarely seen in MDS and AML. It is never seen in healthy persons, never seen in lymphoma and solid tumors. It is also never seen in secondary erythrocytosis, secondary thrombocytosis, and secondary myelofibrosis. So it's very important. Patients with secondary erythrocytosis usually have high EPO levels and JAK2 mutation is negative. Now, when to order this JAK2 mutation in clinical practice? Now, when we have these four conditions, erythrocytosis, leukocytosis, thrombocytosis, or bone marrow fibrosis, one should always order for JAK2 mutation test. Now, again, changing the gears and return back to our four patients. The case number one, this patient had undetectable EPO levels and JAK2 mutation was not found. And even JAK2 exon 12 mutation was not seen, and a diagnosis was made as of JAK2 unmutated polycythemia vera. But later on, when next generation sequencing was done, exon 12 mutation was detected in this patient, though this patient of course had some features of on bone marrow examination which was suggestive of polycythemia vera. In case number two, this patient who is an elderly patient, he had subnormal erythropoietin levels, JAK2 was positive, and bone marrow showed classical trilineage proliferation, and the diagnosis was clear-cut, that was JAK2 mutated polycythemia vera. The third patient, what I've said, was he had EPO was level was high, JAK2 mutations were negative. But this patient had diabetic nephropathy and end-stage renal disease, had undergone renal transplantation, and now following renal transplantation, he has developed secondary polycythemia. So it is very important to remember that renal transplantation can give rise to secondary polycythemia. Now, what are the goals of treatment? Basically, we know that there is no curative treatment for this. The modern therapy can relieve the symptoms, can prolong the survival, and usually these patients live for a median of at least 14 to 15 years. But they can have certain complications which can cause significant morbidity and mortality and can limit the life expectancy. These include certain symptoms like pruritus or splenomegaly, complication like venous arterial thrombosis, or hematologic transformation into myelofibrosis, acute myeloid leukemia, or myelodysplastic syndrome. Now we have to specify how intensive the treatment should be given to these patients. And the risk is assessed on the basis of age and history of prior thrombosis. Patients who are less than 60 years old and have no history of thrombosis are classified as low risk patients. All other patients are considered as high risk. Now, how do we manage low risk patients with polycythemia? Bloodletting or phlebotomy is the major cornerstone of treatment. The aim is to maintain hematocrit less than 45% in males and usually less than 42% in females. Along this, we give low dose aspirin unless there is a contraindication to use. And remember, one should take care of all cardiovascular risk factors like diabetes, hypertension, and cholesterol, and of course, lifestyle modification with respect to diet and physical activity. Now, cytoreductive therapy is usually reserved for those patients who are in high risk group, but it can be given in low risk patients when they have uncontrolled polycythemia vera associated symptoms, or there's a progressive increase of leukocyte or platelet counts, or they have symptomatic splenomegaly, or they do not tolerate bloodletting. Now, phlebotomy basically is done to maintain the hematocrit less than 45 in males and 42 in, and because at this level, the risk of thrombosis is very less, and usually the standard phlebotomy is usually 500 ml should reduce the hematocrit by nearly 3%. Now, once after bloodletting, it is very important that patient should be advised to maintain hydration, should avoid vigorous exercise for next 24 hours after bloodletting. Now, remember that since the aim of phlebotomy is to produce a state of iron deficiency, so none of these patients should receive iron supplementation either in the form of tablets or through dietary advice. Low dose aspirin, usually 75 milligram, is given to all patients unless there is a specific contraindication, except in those patients who have high platelet counts more than 1 million. Because if you give aspirin, there's an increased risk of bleeding because of acquired von Willebrand disease in patients who have more than 10 lakh platelets. Now, the management of high risk, it includes what we have given in low risk patients. Along this, we give cytoreductive therapy in form of hydroxyurea as the drug of choice. But in those patients where this is not tolerated or their side effects are there, could be alpha interferon or busulfan can be given. Of course, the control of cardiovascular risk factors is very important. I've already said hydroxyurea is the preferred agent, and these are the alternatives. And this summarizes in patients who have low risk, less than 60 years, no history of thrombosis, phlebotomy, correction of cardiovascular risk factors, and aspirin are the sheet anchors of treatment. And high risk patients more than 60 with previous history of thrombosis, you add cytoreductive therapy, and phlebotomy is usually is given to speed up or to maintain the target level of hematocrit and hemoglobin. Prognosis, I have already said, survival is at least 13 years who are treated, and untreated patients, the prognosis is less. And other than the age and history of thrombosis, leukocytosis more than 50,000 is an important prognostic, is a poor prognostic factor. Now, with this, I think I conclude my lecture, and this is all I would like to say. And if there are any questions, I would be.